Okay, I think we can start. So good afternoon or good evening in US. I hope there's only two. Okay, so today we're going to start our very first Indonesia Project Global Web Seminar. So welcome everyone. Thank you for joining in this room. So my name is Arianto Arif Patunru from the Indonesia Project at the Australian National University. So this webinar is made possible by ANU with the support of DFAT Australia. So thanks for our supporter. And we're here today to have a conversation with two eminent speakers, our colleague Muhammad Khatib Basri dan Rizky Siregar from US. So we are going to talk and discuss about the course, you can guess, it's ordinary responses during an extraordinary time. So our speakers are Khatib Basri and Rizky Siregar. Khatib Basri, or many people know as Dede, is a graduate of our university here, graduated from Australian National University with expertise on trade, macroeconomics, and political economy. He's a fellow at Harvard's Kennedy School and also a visiting professor here. Taken with visiting professor at the Australian National University. He was a former minister of finance in Indonesia, and before that he was the chief of the investment board. And also, of course, he is with the LPM, University of Indonesia, also before, and which I have the privilege to serve as deputy when he was the director. The other speaker will be Rizky Siregar. Kiki is a PhD candidate at University. Framework to understand this issue, and then later on I will invite Dede to talk about challenges and the policy response in Indonesia, especially in terms of dealing with this coronavirus outbreak. So without further ado, I will invite Kiki to share her slide and start the conversation. Kiki?
Okay, thank you so much, Pak. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. For everyone who is listening and watching. So let me do share my slide first. Wait, why cannot do it now?
Okay. Yes, good.
Okay. Let me make it full screen. So I don't know him. Okay, so this has been a concerted effort from a group of friends, some amazing economists from Indonesia over the past less than a week. We have Gilang in UGM, Mas Rusan at UI, Bang Rizal at Leiden University, Mas Yudis at UI, Henry and Jahan at UI. We are thankful for so many comments also that we have received. This presentation will be about, as Pak Ocho said, will be about a big concept and how we can apply it and how we see it in the context of Indonesia. First of all, I'm sorry, I'm a bit nervous. This is the first time I present in front of two of my former professors. The last time was when I was doing scripsy events 10 years ago. Now with more people to see, so I hope I can deliver the message well. So the idea of policies in times of corona, context of Indonesia, is that first, let's think about how we can disentangle what is going on. So since we are an we are all economists, so this is how we think of the problems. What is the problem set first? We would like to understand first, what is our objectives function, or what's the society or the government's goal, basically. The first and foremost goal in the in this pandemic is basically we just want to save as many lives as possible. So that's the most the biggest priority. The second objective function, or the second goal, is since we need, there are many measures that we need to take in order to save lives, we may have to let go some economic growth or economic activities. So what we want to do is to minimize economic recession. Why I say minimize? Because even if we don't have any virus coming into Indonesia, we will have already the acceleration of growth because of lower growth in the global economy anyway. So what we want to do is to make this process of healing less painful economically. So just a quick graph. This is from Greencast 2020. So if the horizon is the time, while the vertical axis is the severity of recessions, if we take all possible measures that we want to do to save lives, it may be very painful economically, and the recession will be so deep. So what we can do is to minimize this depth of recession and put some measures in macro, both fiscal policy and monetary policy, to make it less painful. So that's the goal. Next, of course, it's not as easy to just achieve the goal. There are constraints. The basic and most obvious constraint is what we have is the capacity of our healthcare system. I think everyone know this very familiar graph right now, the epidemiology graph. What we want to do is that given our capacity of healthcare system here, we want to be able to not overload the capacity. So we want to flatten this epidemic curve into a less steeper one. So basically, that's what we want to do. We want to be able to sustain the healthcare capacity. That's the first constraint. What's the next constraint? The next constraint is, of course, how big government and central bank have influence or capacity in order to affect real sector in the short run. So for example, it may depend on like how big the government budget is, how far we can expand budget deficit if the government will, and how big central banks have influence in the real sector in the short run. The next one that is not obvious, but I think it's real, is that there is heterogeneity in the voters' belief and expectation. What I mean by this is that people may have different expectations in what works. So this may affect how people respond to whatever the government is deciding in order to first save many lives, second, minimize economic recession. So that's all the constraint. But then what are our controls? So what we can choose? So these are the choice variables. First, we have the public health measures. So these are measures that we can take and we can choose in order to save as many lives as possible. This is like the expertise of the public health experts, of course. But basically, learning from the past couple of weeks is that there are two things that we need to do, and they are, both of them are complementary. First is mass tests. The second one is any containment policy. Containment policy can range from very limited fiscal distancing to very aggressive physical distancing. So it can be like now we are in California, we are under shelter in place. Of course, we can still go to groceries, we can still go to banks. Meanwhile, in Italy, for example, they have less of that freedom. But it depends on, I think, how the severity of the pandemic, and it's the expertise of the public health experts. But what we can do as economists, of course, we need to be able to support these public health measures, whatever the choice that we need to take. So what are our tools? Fiscal policy and monetary policy. Pak Dede will go in more depth in this. I will take a bit of what fiscal policy that we can do and monetary policy that we can do later on. So these are the problem sets, and like let's see how we can solve this. First of all, some people still question, is there any trade-off between saving life and saving the economy? So this is a graph that has been distributed by Baldwin a lot. So the upper side is the epidemiology curve. The lower side, the lower panel, is the recession curve, the macro economic recession curve. So I would like to point out this red line, the small red dashed line, which shows without containment policy how big the recession will be. Looking at this, it seems that there is a trade-off, right? Like if we will have high death toll but slower recessions. What I would like to emphasize is that this is not entirely showing the big picture. First, of course, the short-term costs may be small because what we let people still have economic activities running, so the cost may be just like the healthcare system. But if we think about it, we will lose lots of lives here. So, and if we pass through above the healthcare capacity, then first we may trigger panic. We will have stronger expectation for crisis on people. So people may actually self-fulfill the crisis. Second, we will lose lots of human capital. And this is very coronavirus only may be risky for elderly and high-risk patients, but as we overload the healthcare capacity, then it's not only this group of people that are prone to death, basically. Second, we cannot afford having the healthcare system collapsing because, okay, some part of our healthcare system can be easily acquired. For example, we can change hotels to quarantine places or hospitals. We can buy PPE or we can buy masks, but losing doctors and nurses are especially very costly in the long run, because this losing doctors and nurses meaning we lose human capital, which takes a long time to accumulate. So yes, saving lives is a saving equals to saving economy. This is not a trade-off. Second, what is different between economic policy during the pandemic and after the pandemic? I think this is important because now we see that, oh, the standard countercyclical policy may not be suitable during the pandemic, but more suitable for the recovery. What we want to do during the pandemic is basically we just want survival mode. What we want is for people to stay afloat, for business to stay surviving. For them, once the pandemic over, we can go back running. So the countercyclical policy will be more temporary. And since we have limited resources, may be targeted to those that are most vulnerable. Meanwhile, after the pandemic is over, we can focus more on recovery. And we can do the typical standard countercyclical policy, which try to stimulate growth, like aim for higher productivity, stimulate or remove barriers and so on. So this can be more general and more standard. But the one before, like the one currently, we need to focus more that is work that can work for survival mode, basically. So that's the bigger picture of how we would like to plan the policies, but how we can apply it to the context of Indonesia, and I think this is important. First, any public health measures can be effective only if two things. First, people need to be willing to conduct the measures. This is what we call adoption, or in Indonesia maybe we can call it orang harus mau untuk ambil measures ini. Second, people need to be able to afford the measure. So people orang harus mampu untuk bisa ambil measures. For example, if they are daily wage workers, maybe they want to do the measures, but they cannot afford it. So any kind of economic policy needs to support these two things for public health measures to be effective. Just as I wake up today, I learned from the news that the president just announced that the government is choosing in terms of a containment policy. And he emphasized that Indonesia is different. So Indonesia has its own characters that are not the same with other countries. We are totally agree with that. We have specific contexts in Indonesia that are important to be taken into account in policymaking and implementation. First, in terms of social aspects, second on spatial aspects, and the last one on economic aspects. So I'll go one by one and see what's the implication for policymaking in addressing this pandemic in Indonesia. So let's first start with the social aspect, which I think this is also very Indonesia context. So first, I think many people realize that we have a big knowledge gap. Where does this knowledge gap stems from? There is asymmetric information. Perhaps we see that middle and upper class of the society understand better perhaps what's the impact of this pandemic, what's the importance of physical distancing, but less of people who are in lower in a more poorer groups. But we know also that they are actually the ones that are more vulnerable to the impact. So there is asymmetric information that creates this knowledge gap. Another one that may create the knowledge gap is we have not have been having clear guidelines. For example, okay, people encourage, the government have been encouraging people to do physical distancing, but what does it mean? Like, for example, can I go to grocery shop? Like, how often should I do grocery shopping? Can I run, for example? How far can I go to get like basic needs, for example? So we need clear guidelines in this. So what we can first provide information on impacts that are customized to different parts of the society, put all channels that is possible that maybe some parts of the society cannot access this Instagram easily, or they are more into TV, for example, use all kinds of access, even SMS. The next one is engage public figures. This is very important in Indonesia. There's a great paper by Bufifi Alatas et al. In 2020 showing that celebrities do have significant impact when they talk with their own voice. So people will take it more seriously compared to when they endorse from someone external. This next one is that also especially important in Indonesian context, we need to engage religious leaders. This will be even more crucial when as the Ramadan and Eid Fitri is coming. Luckily, this week we have been learning from this amazing guy. I think he has been very, very good in showing how to give a clear information on impact. If you don't care what's the impact to other people, how you can do make a contribution and so on. So maybe we can learn from him, and I hope maybe some audience also learn, are more communication experts and happy to discuss about it. The second social aspect is expectation for a crisis. What do I mean with this? So expectation of crisis is what people believe on what's going to happen in the future, whether there will be crisis or not. This expectation may not be truly a true reflection of real condition. And this is maybe because of asymmetric information. Some people may get like more bad news than the others. And there may be some uncertainty that play a role. So people may speculate more during this time. Despite this expectation may sound very intangible, it drives real action. So for example, if people expect that, oh, there will be not enough food stock, they will do, then we will should expect there is panic buying now. So this managing expectation is very important. What the government can do or what people can do is that provide credible information, use all outlets, make it all timely and clear, send SMS to everyone every day, letting them know how to get resources, for example, what's the updates and so on. And also engage local government networks up to neighborhood level. We have RT RW in Indonesia, which is a good thing. It's a established social capital already. And this we can use that to disseminate information or to coordinate resources. Basically, that's for what can we consider in terms of social aspect. The next one is, I think, important as an archipelagic economy is the spatial aspect. So I will focus more on this on healthcare capacity and see how spatial variation may be very important in drawing policy in Indonesia. So first, let's check out how many numbers of hospital beds we have in different districts in Indonesia. So this all the maps in this presentation will have this spectrum. So the blue one is the dark blue is basically the lowest 20%, and the red one is the highest 20%, and white is basically the median. So we can see that, as we expect, because many most of Indonesian population is in Java, or around half of it, so many hospital beds are in Java. So that's quite like expected. But let's see how is the variation of hospital beds per population. So this is the numbers of hospital beds per population, specifically how many beds hospital beds per 1,000 people. The red one are scattered, Jakarta are one of them. But even in within Java, we have the lowest percentile too. So this is very, very problematic. One, if we cannot contain the virus in the epicentrum and let it spread away, we don't have enough capacity in other parts of Indonesia, and even other parts of Greater Jakarta. As a comparison, for example, for Indonesia, the median is 0.82 per 1,000 population. Jakarta have a bit higher, 1.87. Central Jakarta has higher, like 4 point. Compared to South Korea, they have 11.5, Italy 3.4, Singapore 2.4. So under the current condition, when we don't even have reached the peak, we already, it seems we already overload the healthcare capacity. Let's see what's the numbers of doctors. The same pictures also happens. We see most doctors are located in Java and some in Sumatra. But let's see how doctors overpopulation. This is over numbers of doctors per 1,000 people. The same pictures emerge, which shows that, in big cities, for example, Jakarta and Surabaya, we have higher numbers of this ratio. But even within Java, we are not ready. And compared to other countries, we are way below the numbers of other countries. In other countries, Italy, which we learned right now already, have a very congested healthcare capacity. It has 4 doctors per 1,000 people, and we have our median is 0.2. Jakarta has, Central Jakarta has like 0.005. per 1,000 people. So this is why we learn from the news that how the doctors and nurses have been crying for, they have stretched their capacity. So some takeaways. So first, strong indication that we are already in the limit of this healthcare capacity. So it's in the epidemic curve, we're on that horizontal line. We see that other parts of Indonesia are not well equipped. This can be pros and cons, meaning that given that we have archipelago, we may limit the spread easier, but it also means the contrast is that once it's spread, it will be very bad. We try to learn how other capacity, get data from about other capacity, for example, ICU beds or ventilators. It's so hard to get the data, but there is one news saying that out of the early 132 COVID designated hospital, there are only 88 ventilators, and these are already in the main hospital. So it's a strong indication we are on the limit already at the healthcare capacity. Another aspect, that the last one is economic aspects. In the last 10 minutes, I will try to wrap this up also. So the economics aspect, basically, as we learn, economic policy during the pandemic is basically in survival mode. What we want is to be able for people to survive.
Wow, gigs ekonomi akhirnya muncul, gigs.
So basically, what we can do during this pandemic is to provide safety nets. That's not a typo. I put lots of nets to emphasize that we need lots of nets. So some workers and sectors may hit harder and cannot afford the public health measures. Remember, what we want for the public health measure to be effective, we need them to adopt and afford the public health measures. So we need to provide safety nets for informal workers, daily wage workers, gig economies, sectors that badly hit, and so and other parts of other sectors. Eventually, not only these sectors that may be hit also by the containment policy, some other sectors, for example, perhaps even manufacturing, may also limit productions to comply to the containment policy, which may also need to be supported. But what we can do, we have two arms in the monitor in the economic policy. First arm is the fiscal policies. So fiscal policy should be aimed forward to be temporary. This is not for permanent transfers. It can be targeted because given the limit of the budget or limit of resources, we can target on the one that are more vulnerable. And we need to provide fiscal policy that can be spent directly. We appreciate the move by the Ministry of by the government right now, who already in this line of fiscal policy. They have been expanding cash transfers, will give the kartu prakerja for the safety nets for the unemployed, and so on. The last arm is the monetary policy, and many monetary policy cannot be the typical one. This is more unstandard during this pandemic. It's not enough to only reduce the time. So what monetary policy can do is more about relaxation of credit market, both to workers and to businesses. Not all, this has to be both. I've heard also that OJK has provided some ease for SMEs. And last night I heard that there will be like relaxation for credit for motorcycle, for example, for online driver. That's already great. That sort of monetary policy is what needed in pandemic. What we want, we would like to emphasize is that as the public health measure may take time, since the pandemic will take longer if we flatten the curve, then identification of the most impacted group needs to be expanded. It means also that this transfer needs to be expanded. So what the government and the central bank is to do is like regularly and dynamically reevaluate the impact and then provide more support during the pandemic. There is a questions and worry for perhaps more that these types of policy will have pressures on inflation. And we know that Indonesia is particularly traumatic to inflation due to the Asian financial crisis. Fair, that's true, inflationary pressure will always exist during these circumstances, but we can manage it. And I think saving life now is very important in order right now. So whatever we can manage, we should manage. And how to manage it? There are two sides. Of course, first, this in the supply side is very crucial for us to ensure enough food stocks and smooth distribution. This is this typical aggregate demand, aggregate supply, and I think, I hope Padere will go over it also. So in the demand side, we need to be able to manage people's expectation, not to do in order to avoid speculation, and also in order to avoid panic buying. If necessary, we can also do some controls policies such as quantitative limitation, so people are prevented to do hoarding and so on. And one other thing that we would like to emphasize here is that there is a special case of Greater Jakarta as the epidemic of the center, as the epicentrum of the pandemic. So first, it takes into account more than 2/3 of the detected cases. So it's a true epicentrum in terms of public, in terms of pandemic. Second, it's very well connected, high mobility across within Greater Jakarta. There are 3.2 million commuters each day in Jabodetabek. This is huge mobility. So any containment policy in Jakarta needs to take into account the Greater Jakarta as well. The second one is that Greater Jakarta is more of a consumer in the food sector in the economy. So containing pandemic in Greater Jakarta is part of the effort to ensure food stocks, because we don't want this pandemic to spread more to other parts of Indonesia and risking our food production that are more in other parts of Indonesia. So this can be like we if we want to tackle two things, contain the pandemic and also less painful economically, starting from the epicentrum will be a great idea and very urgent right now. So let me conclude in the next 5 minutes. So first conclusion from all of this is that economic policy that we do during the pandemic are basically a support for the public health policy. So we should put public health policy as first and foremost priority. Second, we learned that healthcare capacity in the epicentrum of the pandemic is already overwhelmed. And we learned also that other parts of Indonesia may not be well equipped if the pandemic spread out. So we propose for a stronger containment measures so that we can sustain the healthcare capacity, especially in the epicentrum area. Why this is important? Because again, the epicentrum, which is the Greater Jakarta, has a very interesting features of it's the consumer of the food products. Second, it's a true epicentrum. So if we are able to contain it more, then we are basically preventing other parts of Indonesia to be more vulnerable. The next one, which I would like to remind you again, the epidemic graph that we have before. Notice that flattening the curve means so time is crucial here. What we can do right now, how long the pandemic will last depends on what we do right now. And in terms of Indonesia, how we do it spatially and socially and economically. And since it will be taking a long shot, so just a quick reminder for everyone and for us all, this is going to be a marathon, but we need to have a full speed sprint in the first 10K. I think that's all for now. Happy to discuss this after. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kiki. It's very excellent presentation, albeit with depressing content. I'm sure everyone is giving you applause. Everyone is muted, but they're giving you a big applause. So I think as you end your presentation saying that time is crucial, but we've been seeing, you know, every day we see this confusion, knee-jerk reactions and whatnot. So with that, I'd like to invite Dr. Kati Basri to give his remarks. So I'd like to invite Dede, and Dede is sharing his presentation now. So over to you, Dede.
Thank you very much, Acho, and good morning, good afternoon, good evening for everyone who are joining the global seminar. I think I really like presentation made by Kiki because she provides a very good conceptual framework. So this makes my life more easier because I can focus on the case of Indonesia. And then I will not speak about the theoretical framework, etc. It's more on the policy response. So on this particular issue, let me use my hat as a former policymakers, and perhaps that insight that I can give is what are the policy options available, what are the constraints, and what will be the implication. Yeah, I think that I will focus on that one. So let me start with this chart. I took it from the social media. I don't know whether this is from Septian Hartono. Yeah, if you look at these charts and the COVID-19 in Southeast Asia, the interesting part is the growth of the number of infected cases in Indonesia is very high. Yeah, even if you compare to Singapore, to Vietnam, to Malaysia, to Philippines, for example, the growth in Indonesia is very high. And if you look at on the right hand side, as of March 22nd, I didn't get a chance to update it yesterday. There were about positive 514 people. infected cases. The death toll, around 48 people. So if we look at the death rate, which is the death toll divided by the number of positive cases, then the death rate was around 9.3%. The interesting part, the recover one was around 29 as of March 22nd. The interesting question is, why the death rate in Indonesia was so high? Is it normal? Is it because we are unable to provide a good treatment because all the issues that stated by Kiki, because hospital are not available, you know, number of paramedics are not available? The honest answer is, I don't know. But I do believe, looking at this number in other countries, the death rate numbers should be comparable. Yeah, because if you look at in any other countries, the death rate will be around 3 to 4%. Yeah. So if you look at the death rate 9.3%, maybe the issue is because the number of positive cases were relatively small. And one of the reasons behind it was because in the initial stage of the corona, the epidemic, Indonesia has just one centralized testing facility under the Ministry of Health Research and Development. Because this limitation, so far, for example, about last week, 1,592 people have been tested, about 6 per million people. Yeah, and then there was a sort of like some issue as well, because we don't play the seriousness of this problem of this corona. So if, let's say, if we assume the death rate is comparable with other country, 3%, then the number of positive corona will be around 1,600 as of March 22nd, because you just divided this, you know, 48 by 3%, right? You will end up with a number around 1,600. And then during the pandemic, people talk about possibility of the expanding about 3 to 4 times a week. So, of course, people can do mathematical modeling for this. But my point is, maybe the real infected cases number are much bigger than this. Then, Kiki's point regarding the availability of this hospital become very relevant. Why is that? It is true that the death rate is relatively small, but the question is, if this happened at the same time, then the ability of the government to handle this issue will be limited. Even if this case is only a cold flu, but if 100 million people get affected by the cold flu at the same time, then there will be a public health problem. So the issue is not about whether this is a serious disease or not, but the issue is because it happened at the same time. Then it will lead into the public policy issue, whether the government will be able to handle it. The next issue is, don't forget, mid of April, we will start the puasa. And after that, we will have Lebaran. As you know, this is a part of our tradition. During the Lebaran, we do mudik, the homecoming. Then you can imagine, if these people from Jakarta get affected, they will spread out the virus into their rural, their desa. And there is no way the government can control it, right? Because even in the Jakarta, in which, according to Kiki, the facility is relatively better compared to outside Java or in the rural area, we don't have enough capacity. What about if this spread out to the rural area, to the desa? So that is why this issue become very serious. I'm gonna skip these channels because Kiki already mentioned about it. But my point is, this COVID-19 crisis, I would call it a crisis, is a combination of the demand shock and supply shock. Yeah, and then in addition to that, there are some issues with the social distancing, the lockdown, which is will have an impact on the goods and services. Yeah, people, etc. I will discuss about this issue later on. Just want to give some flavor of it, because you can see later on when I speak about the stimulus package of the government. Most of the government, many government in the many countries all over the world, were just focusing on the traditional pump priming fiscal policy, which is to boost the aggregate demand. Similar like in the US, they lower the interest rate as a response to the COVID. But don't forget, this issue also include the supply shocks. Look at that. And then just to give the number, Indonesia's MOF, this is a statement made by Minister Sri Mulyani. She said that the GDP growth for 2020 could be between 0 to 2.5%. Yeah, the 2019 growth was around 5%. And then the other scenario was written, there was a very good paper written by our colleague at ANU, Warwick McKibben and Roshan Fernando. Yeah, they used their G-Cube model. I think this is a very important and interesting study. Why? Because most of the scenarios before were referring to the SARS case, because we don't have the data, in which the case of SARS only lasts for 3 months and limited to China. But in the case of McKibben and Fernando's model, they try to look at more on the global impact. So if you look at the scenario four, on the scenario four here, is global, severity is low, attack rate for China is 10%, the mortality rate is 2%, and look at the scenario six for the high impact. Yeah, so I will focus on those two scenarios, the scenario four with the global impact with the low severity, and then global impact with the high severity. Look at this number. If you use the McKibben's number, McKibben's Fernando number, look at Indonesia, the row number two from the bottom. That Indonesia will be affected by minus row 1% from the baseline. If the current growth is 5%, then it means that by 2020, Indonesia will only grow by about 3.7%. And if you look at the scenario six, under the high impact scenario, the Indonesian economy will drop by 4.7% from the baseline, which has become 0.3. So this number is more or less consistent with the number announced by Sri Mulyani from the MOF. So the range, according to McKibben and Fernando, the growth will be around between 0.3 to 3.7%, whereas the MOF said 0 to 2.5. Interestingly, independent institution like Bank Indonesia is more optimistic. They're still talking about 4% economic growth. Yeah, we'll see. Yeah, later on. Yeah, I tend to agree with the MOF prediction. But of course, you know, everyone can do the number crunching about it. My point is, the impact will be very significant, exactly like what Kiki said. And then why is that? Look at this. I took it from Baldwin and DiMauro and their latest ebook about the interconnected hubs. Look at the China, the impact on the supply chains, because China is accounted probably around, you can see in the next slide. Yeah, impact by manufacturing sector. This is can see. Yeah, China share to the global export is around 30%. Yeah, for computer, electronic, optical products. And Chinese intermediate good export, 28%. And Chinese share of gross output, 49%. So my point is, China has become a major of the production hub. So once China get affected by COVID, then there will be a supply disruption. Yeah, this will have an impact, not only from China. And because China slow down, there will be a demand shock, because their demand for raw materials, intermediate goods from Indonesia will decline, which is, will have an impact to our commodity price, like palm oil or mining, like batubara, like coal. And that's explained why the palm oil price decline, the coal price decline. Yeah, so from the demand shock, it's gonna hit export, and also the tax revenue, because most of the government revenue contributed by natural resources companies, especially palm oil and coal. So you could imagine that the tax revenue will decline because of it. At the same time, to make things worse, the oil price is around $26-$30 per barrel nowadays. In our budget, we don't have the subsidy anymore because the one who bear the subsidy is Pertamina. So no positive impact on the spending side because Pertamina will get a benefit of the subsidy. But on the revenue side, the government will lose their PNBP, the revenue from oil. So you could imagine there will be a huge pressure on the fiscal. Yeah. So the ability for the government to spend will also be limited. And not only that, because the commodity price collapse, oil price collapse, look at the situation 2015, at the end of the commodity super cycle. The consumption also get hit. Once the consumption is not there, and there is no incentive for the producer to increase the investment. So from the aggregate demand side, you could see the impact. The economy will slow down. And then the government, I'll explain later on, responded this by introduce the pump priming policy by boosting the aggregate demand. But one thing that many governments all over the world forget, this problem of the COVID also affect the supply side because China is one of the biggest production hub because they also export components to many countries all over the world. So the impact will not only come from the demand side, but also supply side. If this hit supply side, then the global aggregate, the aggregate supply will shift to the left. Under this kind of situation, if you boost aggregate demand, you will end up with the inflationary situation. So it reminds me with the situation like in the 70s when there was a stagflation. Yeah, so the economy grows slowing down. At the same time, the inflation go up. And then in the case of Indonesia, we could see easily that the price of this bawang putih, for example, yeah, the garlic on last February was available from China. Yeah, some companies I spoke to some companies in Indonesia and I'll check with them, their stock only available for 1 to 4 months. And after that, if there is a sort of like logistical issue, they cannot produce. So it's going to hit the production side as well. Yeah. In addition to that, there is a risk of default. This is also from McKinsey. This is a very interesting, because not all of the audience are economists or people from finance. So let me speak in the human language here. Yeah. If you look at on this chart on the right hand side, the share of long-term debt held by companies with the ICR less than 1.5%. The ICR is interest coverage ratio, is basically the total revenue divided by the interest payment that they have to pay. So if the ICR is 1, it means that all your revenue you only need to pay, you could only use for payment for the interest payment. So less than 1.5, it means that your ability for expanding is limited. Interestingly, in the case of Indonesia, look at the orange bar on the right-hand side, 62. Most of the companies which have the ICR is less than 1.5, you can predict. Utilities, infrastructure. Why is that? Because many of these infrastructure projects are not commercially viable. So the question is, there is a risk of default because under that kind of situation. This is before COVID. And then what happened after the COVID? And then let me move to the banking and market risk. Because the risk of default increase, then there is a possibility of the increase of the non-performing loan. Yeah. And the government last night announced the possibility of this to waive, which is I'm very supportive, to waive the interest payment for the companies. Which is my prediction is within probably 3 to 6 months, many company will not be able to pay their debt. So there is a NPL. So if you don't do the relaxation, the banking sector will stop to pour the credit because there will be a credit crunch. Yeah, and then there will be a massive layoff. So the solution is you have to relax this. But there is a liquidity problem here. Why the liquidity problem? If people cannot pay their debt, at the same time, yeah, the government, I'll explain to you later on, because we have the limited fiscal capacity, the government is thinking the parliament yesterday, just yesterday, allowed the government to have the budget deficit to go beyond 3%. Yeah, with the banggar, the budget deficit can go more than 3%, which is the threshold, the new threshold only for this year, 5%. If you're talking 5% of GDP, you are talking about deficit 750 trillion. Yeah, where is the money come from? If you want to finance the deficit, I'll explain to you later on, there will be liquidity squeeze because of crowding out. Because the money from the banking sector will shift from the third party fund into the government bond. So liquidity will become a very issue, will become a big issue. And because of that, the biggest four banks like Mandiri, BNI, BRI, BCA, I think will be relatively okay. But what about a small bank? Because once the interbank stop, then there is, if they want to mobilize one, what they need to do is they have to increase the interest rate. Yeah, if they have to increase the interest rate in order to mobilize one, but at the same time, they have to give a waiver for this, you know, the debt payment. So there will be a liquidity effect of the small banks, small and medium bank. This will have a risk on the financial stability. So that is why this issue might create a problem on the banking crisis as well. So we have to look at this issue carefully. Now let me move. Do I still have time? I hope I'm okay. I'm sure because Kiki finished around 10:32, right? Yeah. So I still have time. Okay. What about the policy response? Let me lay out the stimulus package one. Because at the time, I don't want to put the blame on the government. Because at the time when the government designed the stimulus package one, the situation was very different with the current situation now. So if you look at on the stimulus package one, the government was focusing on the staple food. We call it is BPNT, Bantuan Pangan Non-Tunai, or the Kartu Sembako for staple foods, increased from 150,000 to become 200,000, which is necessary in order to ensure because if you get a problem, one thing that you have to worry about is the increase of the food price. The second policy option, there was a discount on airfare and hotel, 10.3 trillion. Definitely, this policy are no longer relevant because no one will go for holiday nowadays, right? But it was designed under the situation at that time. It was assumed that Indonesia was not affected by the virus. Because as you know, you've been following in the media, the government always said there is no cases in Indonesia. I don't know what's the reason behind it because it was centralized under the Balitbang Kemenkes at the time, but there was no cases. So the way the government designed the policy, they give a discount and airfare. I have sympathetic for this policy. This policy can work under the normal situation because this is the standard pump priming counter-cyclical measures to boost an aggregate demand. Yeah. And then the government also introduced the subsidy for housing because the idea is you have to look at the sector with a high multiplier to subsidize the interest rate and down payment. The idea is if there is an increase on the demand for housing, then there will be a multiplier effect, people will get a job, etc. Again, these policy responses were designed under the normal situation. And Bank Indonesia conducted the triple intervention on domestic bond market, DNDF, spot exchange rate, market, lower interest rate, and lower reserve requirement. This is also the standard monetary policy. Yeah, if you look at the stimulus package one, this is continuation of the stimulus package one, the stimulus package two. The government issues relaxation on various taxes, income tax, both corporate and individual, tax refund, export and import, simplify export and import procedures. All of these policies remind me to my previous life because that's exactly what I did in 2013 when we need to handle the taper tantrum at that time, or 2008 when we had to handle the global financial crisis. So all these policies were focusing on the demand side, on the pump priming aggregate demand. Those policy, I'm not saying that this is wrong policy. Those policy will only be effective under the normal situation. So that is why I think we should go beyond the traditional pump priming policy. And that's why I think, and then before I speak about this, you know, how the government should handle this, let me speak about the last week, last Sunday, if I'm not mistaken, the government announced the social distancing, which is, will have an impact on reduced economic activities, which require a physical presence. I'm using the data from the Bank Mandiri, the EDC, the electronic data, you know, for the purchase, etc., already down by 30 to 50%. Interestingly, grocery supermarket increased by 47% because there was a panic buying. People brought forward their consumption in order, and this is not unique to Indonesia. This happened in Australia. I believe in Australia, the issue is more focusing on the toilet paper. Yeah. Well, this is a very common, because under the panic situation, there will be a multi-equilibria. Yeah. The normal situation, people will not buying, but under the panic situation, people need to bring forward their consumption. Yeah, forward. Yeah. So nothing new with this. This is not unique for Indonesia. And then the increased demand for online. Yeah, I'm using the data from the telco company, because the work from home, school from home, so increase the demand. So it means that somehow the positive impact is economic activities which is using online will increase. But unfortunately, exactly what Kiki says, not all economic activities can be conducted by online. Because it's only, if you're talking about e-commerce, perhaps it's only about 3% of the total e-commerce now. And because the social distancing, because the partial lockdown, negative impact on production, on consumption. Yeah, so I could imagine there will be exactly what Kiki says, there will be an impact on the production and also demand side. Now, what about lockdown? I put the bold in black here. I have no particular expertise on this. So this is my disclaimer. Yeah. But let me put some possible pro and cons here. Perhaps we can have this discussion. Benefit very high if it is implemented in the early stage. Yeah, when they have the potential to prevent the major public health catastrophe, like in the case of Wuhan. But if the disease has already substantially spread, epidemiologists switch from talking about containing the epidemic to slowing the rate of spread. Yeah, because you got economic costs, but you can contain it anyway, right? And the economic costs may be very large. The very simple question, this is probably not on the economic textbook, but speaking from former policymaker, how are you going to distribute the food if you do a lockdown? Only military can do that. You need the national safeguard or military or army, because you need to distribute the food. Or you do the partial lockdown, you allow people go to the supermarket, maybe, you know, how do you control it? You need a very strong distribution system, and this is not going to be easy. Yeah, especially for the country like Indonesia, even for Jakarta, it's not easy. Yeah, the question is, how are you gonna do lockdown in the case of Jakarta, which is the high density? If you go to the slum area in Penjaringan, I recall Aco wrote an excellent piece back on the 90s about Penjaringan, in which, you know, the distance between one household, the other household is only half meter. How are you gonna do social distancing under this kind of situation? How are you gonna do lockdown? Right? This is the you know, the reality on the ground. Yeah, so we have to, so I'm not an expert on this. I don't have a clear view on this, but this is just a pro and cons. So some policy options. To me, until the government can overcome the pandemic, the economy and financial sector will continue to be under pressure. So that is why the government and the regulators, the central bank, should only focus on the pandemic. Yeah, if we try to solve this problem through monetary policy, through fiscal policy, the standard fiscal policy will not work. Because if you recall, even though I agree with Kiki, before the COVID happened, the Indonesian economy has been decelerating, but still 5%, Kiki. Don't forget, which is compared to many countries in the world, it's relatively okay, right? If you look at the stock market about 2 weeks ago, people were still talking about 13,500, the rupiah, right? stock market was still relatively high, and the COVID came. And the way the investor look at it, because they are not really sure how government, not only in Indonesia, all over the world, could handle this issue, then there was a panic in the stock market, in the bond market. And since 40% of our bondholders are foreigners, they dumped the government bond. And Bank Indonesia came to sterilize the bond market by spending already about 300 trillion to no avail. Because as of today, if you look at the non-delivery forward for 1 month, is about 16,500 now, similar like to the, you know, the spot rate. And people were talking, yeah. So we need to focus on the pandemic. So we have to look at the stimulus package in sequencing of response. As I said, traditional pump priming aggregate demand will not be effective. So what are the policy options available? So let me speak here. Short run, we should focus on the health sector. Emergency hospital, exactly what Kiki says. If you're talking about test kits, paramedics, I think Kiki already provided a very good data regarding the availability of the hospital. Yeah. So the government need to allocate funding on this. Maybe if we are not able to build the hospital immediately, maybe we have to follow we can copy the Chinese model, which is using hotel for the quarantine. Yeah, sorry, I just need to check because my internet connection is unstable. Can you still hear me? It's okay? Yeah, okay. Yeah, use a hotel, which is government start to implement this model. And then this give business to the hotel. Yeah, for the not the severe case as a quarantine. The second one, Kiki already said, the social protection. I think BLT, the cash transfer, is the most effective one under this kind of situation. Why is that? Because if you introduce the PKH, the conditional cash transfer, you require the kids go to school. The school are on holiday now. Yeah. If you have to go to the puskesmas, no one will go to puskesmas nowadays. And the government are thinking to implement the Kartu Prakerja, which is to provide training. Who is going to do the training under this kind of situation? Yeah, so the only fiscal, maybe the social assistant can work, is only the cash transfer. I even thinking to go to more radical, perhaps to use the UBI, the Universal Basic Income. Yeah, the TMP 2K, I think Ape is here. You know, perhaps he can share with us later on. He used to work for the TMP 2K. I think they do have the data. But not only that, I do believe that the digital company, the startup, because there are more than 200,000 SIM cards in Indonesia. Yeah, you can use the data from the cellular companies. Yeah, and then if you want to buy a SIM card nowadays, you need to register. Yeah, so somehow, probably, you know, if you want to do the BLT, the cash transfer, you can be quite innovative, maybe using the pulsa and the payment, just sort of like using the wallet, etc. This is just a sort of like, you know, some ideas. The third one, many companies will be under financial pressure. Within 3 to 6 months, they cannot pay their debt. So there should be a relaxation. Yeah, but as I said, there will be a cost on the banking sector. The fourth one, they should focus on the urban. Why is that? Because high density. 55% of the population in Indonesia live in urban. Yeah, interaction in urban. The demand for food is very big in the urban. And if you recall the situation of 1998, because the economic crisis at that time, there was some migration from the urban, to the rural area at that time. If this happened, then the virus can be, you know, the pandemic will be spread out. The fifth one, the social assistant, should using the existing mechanism. If you try to use the new mechanism, no way, because it will take time. And then DCKN, the Jaminan Kesehatan Nasional, or the BPJS, yeah, BPJS Ketenaga Kerjaan. This could be used. For example, I can imagine if you don't provide the BLT, people will draw their BPJS Ketenaga Kerjaan. if they withdraw from the BPJS Ketenagakerjaan, there will be liquidity issue on the BPJS. So the government should top up on this, similar to the JKN. After the pandemic, then you can launch the traditional pump priming to boost aggregate demand. You provide incentive for hotel, for, you know, airfare, etc. Traditional monetary policy. Now let me talk about the long term. Yeah, the long term, I can see a good opportunities in the long term, because one thing that probably people will learn, the global supply chains will change. There is no way that people could afford to put their supply chains only in one particular countries. It's too risky. So they will diversify the global supply chains to all over the world to minimize the risk. And that's exactly, let's speak from my previous chairman of the investment board, the flood in Thailand 2011. Yeah. So I was able to convince Toyota at that time to put the production base in Indonesia, not because I was good, simply because there was a flood in Thailand. Toyota need to diversify their production base, not only in Thailand, but also in Indonesia. And that's the reason why Toyota expanded $3.7 billion at the time. So I can imagine in the future, there will be a sort of like changing of pattern of the global supply chain. Yeah. Now on the financing. So let me spend a bit time on this. And this is because this is a very serious. All this, the things that I mentioned about this health, social protection to protect the small, medium companies need money. China spent for this COVID around $110 billion. Which is in rupiah is probably 1,800 trillion. With the population 1.3 billion. Indonesia's population 250 million. So the amount of money that has been prepared by Sri Mulyani was around 62 trillion if I'm not mistaken. Yeah. Let's say if the government would like to do out of the box huge fiscal stimulus focus on those three issues. Based on the discussion yesterday, allowed to have this 5% budget deficit. 5% budget deficit means that 5% out of 15,000 trillion rupiah, which is 750 trillion, which is 75 billion Australian dollar. Yeah, probably around 70, 75 billion Australian dollar. Then the question is, how do we finance this? Let's say if the government would like to use this 5%, let's say it would like to, you know, use the huge fiscal stimulus. If we go for the local, then you provide a good yield, then there will be a shifting from the third party fund on the banking sector to the government bond. So it means that the banking sector will not be able to lend the money. They will be crowding out. Yeah, liquidity will be very tight, and there is a risk for the banking sector are in crisis, especially the small bank. If the government go for global, the bond yield unbelievably, you know, very high nowadays. Because if you look at the CDS, they will only provide the money provided that the government give a premium, a huge discount. So no, not much option for us. So that is why I'm talking about, you know, some possible option. Maybe we have to think about this to introduce again the so-called the DDO, the deferred drawdown option. What is the deferred drawdown options? During 2013, I had the scheme under the DDO. If the bond yield in the market is too expensive, then we were eligible to borrow money from the World Bank and ADB with only 100 to 200 basis points above LIBOR. So it means that we can borrow money at the concession loan. Yeah, but unfortunately, this DDO scheme is no longer there because the government used it in 2015 or 2016, if I'm not mistaken. So the question is, could we reintroduce again the DDO? Or maybe the government should talk to World Bank, should talk to ADB, or maybe they do the bilateral swap lines with China, with Japan, with Korea, you know, I'm not sure about CMIM because untested. Yeah, or maybe with China, if our relationship is pretty good with China, why don't we ask to support for the in-kind, paramedics, medicine, test kits, etc. But I think this is a very serious issue. If we are not able, I'm thinking to, because if you're talking about we don't have the number, what will be the number of the infected cases? But if you're looking from this, you know, the growth is relatively high, then maybe Indonesia should open like what we had during the tsunami, to open to the international support. The reason behind it is because if we have enough capacity to finance the fiscal, then that will be good. I'm not worried about the deficit. You can go under this time, you know, you can go to the as high as possible for the temporary. But the question is, how do we finance this? Because the global economy is in a difficult situation as well. So I think I stop it here. Thank you very much, Acho. So let me stop share.
Sorry, can you hear me? All right. Thanks again, De, for a very clear presentation, while equally depressing as Kiki's presentation. So now I'd like to remind everyone that if you want to raise question, please click the raise hand button on your screen so I can see. Let's start with Firman Witular. Ujang.
Okay. Hi, everyone. Thank you, Kiki and Dede, for the excellent presentation. So, well, I think I at the beginning, Kiki started with the multiple objectives, which is public health and economic objectives. I think we all agree that are what we're facing. But I think in the public discourse that has been going on, and not in Kiki's paper, that can actually be misleading, because it's almost as if we are discussing a decision that have to be made at the margin. Trying to find just the optimal health and economic intervention in moving along the curve of the production frontier. And I think this is misleading, because I think what we ought to be thinking at this point is a single objective, which is keeping economic activity afloat, subject to stopping the spread of COVID in its track. So the constraint has to be binding and has to be met, that is stopping the COVID spread. And I think we should try to emphasize this stronger, which I think what Dede suggested in the short term. We deal with the COVID first, and deal with the long term later. So I think what we need is for leadership that can change this public discourse. And I think it's probably our duty as economists to try to steer the discourse in that direction.
Thank you, Jack. Before we go back to Kiki and Dede, let's take two persons at a time so we can maximize the use of time, make it more efficient. So let's go to Budi. Mas Budi?
Could see me. Yeah. So thank you, Dede and Kiki, for the presentation. It's broad, but I just thought, same as Firman, we are not focusing and much stronger put emphasis on the cost, on handling the cost of the problem, which is the health issue. You know, all the economic impact are the second derivative of the first activity. Now, I personally take the situation in a very, very pessimistic way. Suppose that 2% of people is actually passed away, they're affected, and Java, Indonesia got that amount of people. And if it is the size of the people that pass away already passing like 100 million, I'm not sure that we don't have a chaos. So either you could detect it and whether our facility, health facilities, available or not, this fact is happening. So we do not want to detect it. It doesn't matter whether you will be able to detect it or not. If the amount of people pass away has been high, it will be chaos. So the number one is handling the health issue. Now, Bang Dede and Mbak Kiki is not really putting on the size of the amount of money that we need to deploy. You know, I thought that 60 trillion, which is like 0.5% of our GDP, is a bit too small. Yeah. Too small comparing to you know, the general Australia put 10%. Most of the European country put around 5%. So we need to be brave enough to encourage government to be ready to put more budget on this issue. And a lot of this budget is, number one, to curb the problem. You know, put more money in the health sector. And then second is, I agree with Dede, with the social safety net. Yeah. Now, the other thing about deficit, I thought in this kind of crisis, reducing from increasing deficit from 4.45 is showing that we are not serious looking at this crisis. I thought that we need to probably allowing deficit more than that, much more than that, like 10%, 50%. You could do it temporary, so just for 1 year, and then after that you could be back on board. So again, the way that the style that both Kiki and the presentation is assume that even we don't do anything, the end we are survive from this pandemic. But that is something that I'm not sure. Thank you.
Thanks, Mas Budi. Over to Kiki and Dede. Kiki, you want to take a first shot? Oh, sorry.
Kiki, you want to respond first, yeah. Or I can wait.
Pak Dede, you can go first. Oh, shall I?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, I agree with everyone. I agree with what Pak Ujang said, Mas Ujang said, and Pak Budi said. I thought my slide is already depressing. I didn't want to make people more depressed. To be honest, I cried several times creating the slides. So I agree. And I think maybe it's my fault in not delivering what the emphasis that we want to put actually here is that first and foremost is the health sector. First and foremost is the public health concern. Whatever the... Yeah. Since I am an economist, and I think that's how Fadedi also put himself, we are not a public health experts. What we would like to emphasize is that what the public, if public health experts say that we need to do A, B, C, then we should be able to provide it. And I agree with Budi mentioning about the budget deficit. I hope the government is courageous enough to increase it. I agree. And we can take, we have very smart people in the government right now handling our treasury, so we can put an internal important right now. Yeah, I think so, and we should do it better, I think, as an economist.
Okay, Dede?
Okay, let me use my slide again, because I completely agree. I think Firman and Budi, we are on the same page, yeah? Because to me, as I said, if you look at this, the stimulus package number 3 should considering sequencing of responses, which is on the short term, to me, just need to focus on the health, social protection, and companies under financial sector. Only 3. Forget about everything. Forget about the economic impact, etc. Forget about pump priming. Forget about aggregate demand. That's what I call the standard counter-cyclical. Now the question is, so we are in this, on the same page on this. I completely agree. We just need to focus on the health, because there is no way we can solve this problem, as I said, you know. There is no way until the government can overcome the pandemic, the economy and financial sector will continue to be under pressure. So we should focus on the pandemic first. So that's the, so I don't see the different about opinion on this. But let me talk about financing now, Budi. Let's say I took your number, yeah, 10% of GDP, okay? Our fiscal, our GDP 1% number.
1%.
1% of GDP. Yeah. This is actually, this is the budget deficit, allow 5% of GDP.
Oh, 5%, budget deficit 10%.
10%, yeah, budget deficit 10% of GDP, okay? 10% of GDP, bear with me with the number, it means that 1,500 trillion. Okay? Then my very simple question is, sure, where is the money come from? Right? If you want to use the whole money in the banking sector, move to the government bond, there will be a crowding out. Because the pool of fund is simply not there. Okay? If the government would like to, in order to finance the deficit, the government would like to issue bond, 1,500 trillion, $150 billion, at what rate? You want to pay 15% at the US dollar? Right? The next question is,
possible financing from the World Bank through the DDO, deferred drawdown option. There are useful briefing documents about the DDO on the World Bank site, which are available by Googling World Bank DDO. So if anyone wants to know more about DDO, just follow that instruction by Peter. So please thank continue
that. Thank you, Peter.
Okay, yeah. So
maybe one of possible options is deferred drawdown option.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, sure, continue? Sure. Go ahead.
The DDO. But the question is, can World Bank and ADB help us with 1,500 trillion, $150 billion? Even the IMF, not really sure, because all over the world are in trouble now. So, Budi, I think the issue is not because I disagree with you regarding the, you know. I think yesterday Carmen Reinhart put a very interesting article about this out-of-the-box fiscal stimulus, with this I completely agree. But the question is, where is the money come from? In the case of China, they could spend $110 billion. But what about in our case? That's why I'm really worried about it, because our ability to handle this issue is limited. That's what I said, that go for the international support. I think I stop share here.
Okay, thank you, Ki Dede. The next on the list is Anissa and Risa, but let's take three now, because I think in the interest of time, if Kiki and Dede can remember the questions, I appreciate that. We take three persons. And the third person I would like to invite is Mas Haryo Aswicahyo. No? As I understand, Mas Haryo has been circulating good information on the social media, and I'd like to hear
lockdown outweighs the consequences. So that's my main question. Thank you.
Thank you, Anissa. Risa, hold on.
Thank you, Pak Cho. Thank you, Pak Dede and Buriski, for the explanation. I'm Risa from a finance student at the ANU. I want to ask about the banking sector. In this current global uncertainty, I believe that a banking sector faced one of the hardest time after the 2008 crisis. Mm-hmm. Export definitely will slow down and domestic consumption will also get hit. Mm-hmm. So prime industry like palm oil will also get difficulty, and infrastructure as Dede said, is having less than 1.5 ICR. If I can just probably, I prefer a zero growth loan for the banking sector. As you mentioned that we will have tight liquidity, but it probably won't help the country economy sector. My question for Pa Dede, in this kind of situation, what do you suggest for the banking industry? Are we going to conservative growth or even zero growth lending? If we continue, what kind of industry that's still favorable to participate in Indonesia at this moment? I'm thinking of healthcare and probably telecommunication. You mentioned the increase of internet usage can be an option, but I'm not sure with the other industry. Thank you.
Now I invite Mas Haryo.
In addition to the where the money come from, at first Pak Dede says about inflation a lot, supply side problem. So if the higher the budget deficit, the higher the spending, means higher inflation in the future, right? So it means that the important is purchasing power, correct? So if we spend a lot for social protection, which is of course, but we also have to consider the inflationary effect. Mm-hmm. So has it been calculated or scenario? So in addition to the problem of financing, there is a problem of inflation, which also reduces the purchasing power. So if we have, if the BLT is 500 million, 500,000, and the inflation shoot, so it doesn't work, right? And also the choice is not between between infected or not, but between infected and starvation, right, in Indonesia. So there is a lot of dilemma here. So the extreme solution, I think, is not appropriate. In the situation where there are a lot of dilemma, extreme solution may be counterproductive. So it's sequencing, very targeted, is very information. I would like to share the current situation of the growth of my graph, which is updated daily. I can give the link, direct link that will be updated daily automatically. The growth of the cases is still very high, similar to Australia, similar to UK, similar to US, Indonesia's growth rate. Can I share the screen?
Okay. Is it ready on your side so you can?
Yes. Quick. Oh, wait a minute. Oh, so maybe I can say it because I don't know how to do it. Okay. Can you see the?
Hold on. I may have to make you co-host now. Can you?
Yes. This is. Can you see the graph?
No, we can't.
Oh, okay. No, it's okay then. Forget it. So I just mentioned it that Indonesia is still very high, and there is no sign of flattening. So brace for the time, brace for the virus. Mm. Yeah, I think that's my comment about inflation, especially.
Okay, thank you, Mas.
Maybe second one. They did tell about the possibility of debt crisis. How serious it is nowadays? Because there are also many safeguard has been placed. Like you have to hedge your debt. You have to have certain percent of asset compared to debt. So do you have the number for that so that we know the possibility of systemic crisis in Indonesia? Because if there is a systemic crisis, we are in trouble, right? Okay, that's my question.
Okay. So over to Dede and Kiki. Maybe Dede, you.
You have any, because the answer is I don't know. Yeah, the pro is a very dilemmatic. Let me talk about the banking. My biggest concern, and this is also in response to Haryo's question, my biggest concern for the banking sector is liquidity. You don't need to worry about the credit growth, either zero growth or, but the issue is always liquidity. Because if there is a credit crunch, there will be a liquidity crunch, then there will be an impact on the systemic banking crisis. Yeah, I don't have the number, Mas Haryo, at this moment, but I will say at this moment, the liquidity is still okay. But the question is, let me try to talk in a very simple language. Let's say our debtors, our customer in the banking sector cannot pay their debt. Yeah, cannot pay their debt within 6 months or 1 year. So no payment. At the same time, banking sector need to pay the interest rate for the deposits, right? The third party fund. So banking sector should run a negative carry. So it means that there will be a drop of the liquidity very high. For the big banks, as I mentioned, the tier 4 like BCA, Mandiri, BRI, maybe they have enough balance sheet. What about the small bank? Once people worry about it, the people will move their savings from the small bank into the big bank. Then, in order to respond to the situation, the small bank should raise the interest rate. Yeah, the interbank will stop. So that is the potential of this banking. I don't have the number, but I think the government, especially the FSSK, need to be very careful on this. The question about industry, I think this is not talking about this, you know, business, because with the social distancing, with the partial lockdown, there will be no business activities anyway, except, you know, I'm not talking about this potential sector. I don't want to encourage you for this, but you know, the adagium under this kind of situation is always cash is king. Yeah, because liquidity, liquidity, liquidity. On the inflation, Mas Haryo, exchange rate 3 weeks ago was 13,500. Now it's 16,500. So the depreciation already about 25%. Given at the food price, I'm not talking about the impact of the BLT, etc., the inflation of food already should increase by 25% already. Because this, as simple, because the depreciation of the rupiah. Right? So this is going to hit the, you know, the purchasing power. In the beginning, I was thinking, you know, maybe even not to giving a BLT to the So my response on the inflation, even without the increase of budget deficit, etc., the inflation I can bet the inflation is going to, you know, to increase. That's what I'm concerned. That is why several times I said that be careful with the food price, because this could induce the social unrest. Yeah, but I completely agree with you. There is no single extreme solution. This is a public policy. We are talking always the suboptimal, maybe not the second best, maybe, you know, second worst. What everything, as long as this could be effective, you know, we have to try to implement it.
Okay, Kiki.
Okay, I think I will try to answer the first question from Anissa from DFAT. Also, unfortunately, forecasting is a very, even in normal situation, is a very tricky job for economists already, I think. So in this situation, it's hard to do the forecast because it depends on what kind of public health measures we can do. And because given the public health measures, that will determine how long the pandemic will be, how severe the pandemic will be. So what I would like to emphasize, at least given my presentation also and given the information that we have found, at least for the epicentrum of the pandemic, we have a very overloaded healthcare capacity already. If people die, and this is even before we have massive tests, so we don't know exactly like the detected number of people being positive of COVID, maybe is a lower bound instead of the actual numbers. So given the situation, and we would like to focus on health sector right now, I think policymakers should think clearly that any kind of choices will be hard, but make sure that what we want to do right now, first and foremost, is to save lives. I think that one thing, one part. Second, and we want to sustain the healthcare system. So if we cannot sustain it, this isn't going to be a long marathon. So that straight line of healthcare capacity can actually not straight, but it goes down if we have overloaded healthcare capacity. I agree with the Adede in terms of questions on, for example, inflationary pressures, which I also put out. And I think one of the point that we need to take into account is that one part of the inflation is, of course, the volatile food. So food stock really matters here, and the distribution really matters here. I take into account that too. And but it's a risk that we want to, the risk is always there. Like, but what we can do is to manage it, right? One part of it is, I think this from the supply side, Jakarta is basically consumers. So I think saving the producer side, like making sure that the producers can still produce, that already help part of the problem. It's not half, but part of the problem. Second, managing people's expectation, make sure that they don't feel that the crisis will be even worse, and not in denial of how severe the problem is, helps in managing panic buying or avoiding panic buying and so on. So our inflation right now is around 3%. Given the depreciation, I agree there will be some imported inflation, but it will be, I think, even more if we cannot contain the virus or if we cannot contain the pandemic. So first and foremost, any kind of problem in the economics, European depreciation, lack of speculative or a lot of speculative buying, it all stem back to how we can deal with the public health measures.
Thank you, Kiki. And there are two reactions from ANU professors, first by Terry Hall and then Hal Hill. Let me read a question from Terry. As the health system crumbles and the business shutters, the issue of how to generate accurate data on the trends growing out of the COVID-19 spread and the recession will be made all the more difficult. How will BPS work in the field? What data will be reported by the health sector? Certainly right now there is a huge undercount of cases and deaths. So please hold on, and then let's move to Hal Hill. Hal, you there? Hold on. Okay. Hal? Okay. Silakan, Pak.
Okay.
Yes, we can hear you.
So, thank you, Acho, and hi to everybody. Hope you're all safe and well. I really had very little to comment on, but I just, except to say mainly, thank you very much, Dede and Kiki, for two excellent presentations. Very comprehensive. I enjoyed them very much. Just a couple of really minor, almost trivial points to mention briefly. First of all, just setting the scene, I wonder whether it's useful, you've said it implicitly, maybe it's worth saying it a bit more explicitly, that that you have a bias. I mean, I think this is what you're saying, and it's what I believe. You have a bias that if in doubt, go harder and go earlier than what you might otherwise. It's better for governments to overdo the stimulus and then retreat and to overreact rather than to wait and underreact. First point, sort of scene setting. Second point is, I guess it's perhaps useful, again, it's implicit in both your presentations, to kind of keep in mind the so-called assignment principle, that is, number of instruments is equal to the number of objectives, and the objectives, where, as they're in health, in fiscal stimulus, in monetary policy, in financial policy, I guess it's just a useful reminder for policymakers to have a to have an instrument corresponding to each objective, since a lot of the public discussion tends to be a bit all over the place, and not in this seminar, but in the general public discussion. So perhaps it's worth reminding the general public for this presentation. Second point is of the question of coordination, which was touched upon, especially by Dede. I guess the coordination issue is quite critical in two levels, isn't it? One is between the national government and the local governments, especially given Indonesia's division of responsibilities on education, on health, and a lot else. So at some stage, I guess that's worth spelling out somewhere. I know the government's thinking about it and talking about it. And the other issue is international coordination, which Dede touched on. One of the lessons, I guess, from the global financial crisis 2008-09 was actually that international coordination was reasonably effective. That was mainly to do with fiscal stimulus and ensuring that countries didn't do beggar thy neighbour exchange rate depreciations. In this case, it's a different ball game, but with the upcoming G20 meeting and other international fora, for example, I noticed Yusuf Anandi has a piece on the role of the EAS. It is actually rather important, since in the global environment at the moment, the two economic superpowers are still at loggerheads. So it is actually making international coordination and cooperation more difficult. So they're just two very minor comments. There's really no need to respond. Just can I add one other PS, an obvious one, but this would be a great opportunity for the government to lock in the international oil prices, to lock in the internet link between the international and domestic oil prices, and forever remove the oil subsidy completely, the fuel subsidy problem completely. And the second very minor point is, I guess in this era when we're going online, the quality of telecoms is really crucial, and I wonder whether that is being talked about much as an issue in Indonesia. So once again, thank you very much for two excellent presentations.
Thank you, Ha. Over to you, Ki.
Pak Dede, silakan.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I don't have any specific comment, especially a question from Terry Hall. I don't have an expertise on this about the data from BPS. On a comment from Hal, I think I completely agree with all the comments made by you, Hal, especially the Tinbergen's rule about the coordination between local and central government. I was trying to be very diplomatic on this, because if you look at this central and local government, I get the impression that many policies been an initiative of every region now, because still not clear about the direction, then that makes the people a bit worried and concerned about it. And this related to the local. Let me give an example, a clear example. About last week, for example, Anies Baswedan announced to reduce the frequency of the transportation in Jakarta. And on the afternoon, the president canceled it. Just to give a sort of like anecdotal evidence that this coordination, exactly what you said, become very difficult. And several times the central government said that the lockdown, the decision for lockdown can only be done by the central government. But in many cases, you know, partial lockdown has been implemented by the local government. Even the Bupati of Tegal said, you know, announced that the lockdown. I don't know whether he or she understand about what will be the implication of the lockdown. Yeah, so this is a really an issue, Hal. About the oil price, I completely agree with you, Hal. And even I was worried, but hopefully this is not to happen, because there was a discourse that the government would like to lower the oil price, the gasoline price, because now the oil price is around 26. To me, this is my personal opinion on this. What the government needs to do is to keep the domestic price, and the difference could be treated as a surcharge. Yeah, let's say the difference between international price and domestic price is 1,000. The consumption is about 60 million kiloliter. If you impose a surcharge, you get easily 60 trillion, and you can double the fiscal stimulus. If you impose the surcharge to 1,000 rupiah, I don't know, we need to do some calculation of it, then easily you are talking about 120 trillion from the excise of the BBM. And nowadays, people not complain anyway about the gasoline price, right? But there was a discussion saying that the it has come from the government themselves to explore the possibility of lowering the price. My second concern is, if you lower the price, we don't know whether this is temporary or not, because simply it was driven between the price war between Saudi Arabia and Russia. So once the price come back to the normal price, I don't think the government will dare to take an action to normalize the domestic gasoline price. So that will be my comment. But the rest, I have nothing to add. I complete.
Thank you, Kiki. Brief response.
Yeah, I really appreciate all the comments, and I think I don't have anything what said. I think what I would like to emphasize is again the coordination. All of the many problems will stem from lack of coordination or unclear coordination, especially now. I think we should also think that the without any aggressive measures of public health policy, then the virus spread naturally, like it distribute. So a stronger engagement between national and local level will be very much needed, even more later on. I would like to also point out the international coordination. I learned when I was undergraduate students of Pacho and Padede from how great G20 worked during global financial crisis. And I think we cannot hope that much of constructive cooperation right now from G20, because everyone is struggling, and given the leaders of G20 are not now as how to say it diplomatically, as not in the same page to do coordination. Perhaps I would like to point out, maybe it's not been like point out more, but like it was said that maybe we can take from the World Bank, but also other types of international banking, multilateral financing, for example, ADB or World Bank or other nation. I mean, Padede, I leave it, and maybe like some other audience here know better. So happy to learn from you guys.
Thank you, Kiki. Thank you, Dede. Actually, our time is up, so I will just, I'm sorry to everyone else who has raised their hands, but I can only accommodate two more questions, but very brief, only one question each, and that goes to Faris Abdurrahman and Rifana Mezaya. And all those who submitted question in written form, I'll make sure to convey your question to the speaker. Sorry about that. So Faris, are you ready? And then after that, Rifana, we will take your questions. Very short questions, please.
Is my voice clear?
Go ahead, Faris. Yeah.
Okay. So my question is, I'm Faris. I'm an undergraduate student at University of Indonesia. So my question is, there are some that are saying that the impact from the coronavirus pandemic is going to be perhaps far worse than even the Great Depression. And with regards to that, I just would like to ask, what would be the long-term impact to Indonesia? As in previous periods of crisis, the 1998 crisis or the 2008 crisis led to slower future growth. Is this sort of hysteresis or secular stagnation also going to be likely occurring also in the future? Is the growth forecast for Indonesia going to be permanently slower than it was before the pandemic?
Okay, thank you, Faris. Rifana?
Thank you. Thank you, Pak Dede and Kiki, for the excellent presentation. Disclaimer, I'm not an economist, so I just want to know, building on Kiki's point on the informal sector in Indonesia that makes up pretty much a lot of our economy, is there any special stimulus policy that can be addressed to the informal sector? Because I think what I've seen right now is the government is trying to implement BLT or something is more to an individual that works in informal sector. But for the sector itself, what will be the possible stimulus? Because, for example, I work at Grab now, and we've been instructed by the government to focus on delivery and food. But actually, delivery and food will not happen if the merchants that are mostly in actually informal sector also cannot stay afloat and be in operation. So just wondering what's your take.
Okay, second, Kiki.
Yeah, I think for first question to Faris, the long-term impact to Indonesia, this will be, I think, changing course. But many of them, like how, I think the next path depend on how we deal with the pandemic. Again, what I would like to emphasize is losing so many people will, it means also like we lose human capital, which takes time to accumulate. So it will, yeah, it can be dire. And there are learning from Spanish flu, for example, lose those countries that lost. So yes, it will be very long-term, and how permanent, I don't know. Second questions, okay. This is Meza is my friend, actually. Thank you for the question, Meza. But I totally agree. And I emphasize in my presentation also that we need to be to support not only workers, but also businesses. So I didn't go in depth in what kind of transfer that they what we need to get. But yes, we need to get transfers to the UKM, or at least OJK now already waived some or delay some payment for UKM. We also learned, I don't know whether it's coming, but it seems that the Ministry of Finance is working on it. But yes, in order, if we want for first, if we want the UKM or like the informal sectors to be precise, to stay afloat, and if we to be able to restart again after the pandemic, we need to make them stay afloat. Maybe like direct transfers, or including also delay of payment, not only on interest, but also on principal.
Thank you, Kiki. Dede?
I have nothing to comment. I agree with Kiki, so we can go.
All right. So with that, we thank the speakers, Dr. Kati Basri, also Kiki Rizky Siregar. It has been very fruitful discussion. And we at the Indonesia Project, thank you so much. And also thanks for everyone. Thanks for participating. Thanks for listening. And I apologize once again for those who we cannot accommodate because we actually way past our time limit. So again, thank you. So with that, we close this discussion now.
Thank you.